associate professor of health and physical education. She received her bachelor of science degree from Brighton Polytechnic in East Sussex.
Wow.
I looked that up.
I was going to say, I didn't put that down.
And her PhD was awarded in December of '05 from Auburn University in Auburn, Alabama. She joined the HPE department here at ENMU in the fall of 2006 and quickly became the grad coordinator for that program. She stayed in the grad coordinator position until the summer of 2014. Dr. Wall teaches in the areas of motor behavior, exercise physiology, and research methods. She says she is a cat lady, apparently taking them hiking, biking, snowshoeing, and camping.
I do take them camping.
Dr. Wall says that wine and chocolate are important, I assume either together or separately.
Either, absolutely. Preferably together, but only on the group.
So please join me in welcoming Dr. Sarah.
So thanks very much for coming. I know everyone is really busy, so I very much appreciate taking time out and coming and supporting and finding out what HPE and the CDC are up to out on the playground. The first thing I'd like to do is to recognize my co-authors. This really, I'm the one who's up here chatting away, but it really is a collaborative effort. I couldn't have collected the data on my own. I had the idea, but without everybody's help, this would not have happened. So Dr. Beth Berkey is our pedagogy specialist in HPE, and Dr. Culpepper is the chair of the department, and we're very happy to have him there. And Mrs. Elaine Gard is the director at the Child Development Center, and really nothing would happen without her cooperation and the CDC providing an environment for us. So we're very happy to have that collaboration with their facility. And I want to mention, we had a couple of students helping us out a lot last semester, and Aaron Massey, our undergrad student. And I want to give Aaron a shout out because he is actually going to be presenting a portion of this data that he and Dr. Culpepper worked on at the National Undergraduate Research Conference in Asheville, North Carolina during April. So we're very proud that he got accepted at that conference, and he'll be representing the department and the university in Asheville. Dylan Metzger, one of our graduate students, was a big help, and he kind of organized and did all the running around and delivering and picking up, and it would have been very difficult without him taking that role. So, okay, so what were we doing? Where did the ideas come from? I had three strands of information buzzing around in my head, and I was trying to think of a way of putting them together, not very successfully initially. The first strand of info was the idea of physical activity and motor competence. We have a well-established link in the literature, and when you look at national bodies, between the lack of physical activity in the population, doesn't really matter which age group you look at, the problem is an overarching issue. People on university campuses tend to be atypical and tend to be pretty active. That is not the typical picture across the population. And so this lack of physical activity is increasing health risks, particularly when you look at type 2 diabetes, obesity, certain types of cancers. So it's a really big problem. And people who are trying to impact the health problem are finding issues with keeping people engaged in physical activity or exercise programs. They start, they know it will be good for them, and then they don't continue. They drop out for a number of reasons. Some may be financial, some may be family oriented, some may just be, this is boring, I don't want to do it, I don't care enough, right? So one of the, hold on, sorry. One of the motor behavior concepts that we believe is that developing fundamental motor skills. So fundamental motor skills can be locomotor or object control, things like throwing or striking, running, jumping with 2 feet, hopping with 1 foot. Those are all fundamental motor skills. Everybody, in theory, should be able to do those skills relatively well. If we develop our fundamental motor skills, they act like the building blocks, the bricks, for being physically active as we get older. Because without those, it's difficult to develop a skill set to be physically active. If I want to play tennis in school or as an adult, I've got to be able to run, to leap, to strike in order to be successful in tennis. If I'm not successful at it, I don't want to do it. Right? Humans are not very good at persisting at things they are not feeling they're enjoying, they're being successful at. If I suck, I quit, right? That's the way it goes. So if I'm not very good at moving, then I don't enjoy moving and I don't stay with moving. And a model was proposed by some colleagues. Dave Stobb and Jackie Goodway proposed the initial version of this model back in 2007. And I've done a lot of reading around it. I really like this model, and I'm going to try not to get too involved here because I get a bit carried away with the model. And then they presented a slightly adapted version with a bigger group of researchers in 2008. So here in the center of the model here, in red, we have motor competence and physical activity. And what they were looking at was, okay, we think that being motor competent, if I am skilled at moving, I'm going to be more physically active. Well, what they started talking about and what they were thinking of when they presented the model was that this relationship between the two factors is actually dynamic. It doesn't stay the same across early childhood into later childhood and into adults. And that there's a developmental aspect to this relationship. And so what they propose is that when we are in early childhood, so when we're looking at 3, 4, 5, 6-year-olds, that the amount of physical activity they get, and therefore the amount of practice and the amount of experience they get with moving, drives their competency in their motor skills. So the arrow goes right to left here because it's how motor competent they are is dependent upon how physically active they're being and the opportunities that they're getting to be physically active, right? And then as we move into middle childhood and later childhood, we see a switch. And what happens with the slightly older children and going into teenage is that how motor competent they are now starts to drive how physically active they choose to be, right? So one of the variables that interrelates with this idea is perceived motor competence. So when we look at young children, their perceptions of how good they are at moving are completely scoopy, right? They think they're brilliant at moving. One little boy on Monday said, Miss Sarah, look at my running moves. I can run faster than anybody. Well, this child, bless, he's lovely, but this child has really poor running patterns. His legs are very weak. He barely leaves the floor. His running is horrid, but he thinks he's great at running, and so he practices running. Hopefully, he will improve in running because he wants to practice it. He thinks he's good at it right now. But as we get older, as we transition to middle childhood, we start to compare ourselves to our peer group. And we start to compare what we're doing to what they're doing and realize that maybe we're not as good as we thought we were. And so perceived motor competence in middle childhood and late childhood starts to be much more accurate to actual motor competence. What is my actual measure of competence versus what I think I can do? And so once I start to think I'm not very good at something, then I try to avoid doing that thing. And then if I'm not practicing, my motor skills get worse, my actual ability, my actual skill measure declines, and then I drop out even further from the physical activity. So the model kind of really, really describes something I had believed for a long time. Everybody in motor behavior kind of thought this. We just hadn't had a picture of it previously. And they also looked at health-related fitness in relation to the picture as well. And so what we get on the model is that children in middle and late childhood in particular who are motor competent, i.e. very skillful at fundamental motor skills, tend to perceive themselves as skillful, and therefore they enjoy moving. And so they are more, they choose to be more physically active, so they could go out in the garden and play rather than watch a video. Or they hassle mum and dad to let them play Little League or any other kind of kids' activities that are going on at the weekend at the rec center. And so they then have higher levels of physical activity, they develop healthy weight. Healthy weight positively feeds into your motor skills because if I'm not carrying additional weight that isn't helping the skill, I can jump higher, I can run faster, and so the cycle has a positive loop. On the other hand, if I have children who are less skilled and they perceive themselves as less skilled, then they will opt out of physical activity. And if they're not being physically active, we see developing unhealthy weight and obesity, and we have a negative spiral back into the model because now they're carrying additional weight that impacts how well they can do the skills. In New Mexico, New Mexico Department of Health gives us figures for 6 and 8 year olds every couple of years on overweight and obesity, and at 6 we have a 33% overweight obesity rate in New Mexico. So a third of 6 year olds in this state are overweight or obese. By the time they're 8, the literature says if you are overweight or obese at 8 years old, you have a 60% chance of being an overweight adult. So if we're already overweight by 6, the chances of not being overweight by 8 are pretty poor, and the chances of not being an overweight adult are pretty poor in this state. So we've got a real problem going on. So can we get the children more physically active, right? That seems simple. Well, let's just get them more physically active. The problem is that we're not doing, we're not making much progress there. If we can get them more physically active, we can minimize their risk of obesity. And one of the ways that children are going to be physically active is by modeling. Modeling is important throughout the lifespan. It's important for our students. We know that if we're standing up in front of the class going, okay, today we're getting great, then we already lost them. Okay? So it's important for our students, it's important for us, it's important for elderly people. One of the problems with getting elderly populations engaged is that we do not have a lot of modeling for elderly. We don't show Senior Olympics on the television, so they don't get to see that. If you go to the gym, quite often you'll be the only older person in the gym. There's not modeling. So it's always in early childhood, it's critical to get modeling. It's really key. Modeling by significant adults in their lives, whether it's their parents, older siblings, family members, or for many children in this country, their teacher at preschool, then that has a powerful impact. Children learn by watching. What you do when you are with the children is vital, right? So if early childhood teachers are engaging in physical activity and they're doing motor skills and going, oh, this is fun, I love this, then that would encourage children to be more physically active when they're on the playground. So that seems reasonable and pretty simple. Early childhood guidelines, best practice guidelines in early childhood literature recommend that adults don't watch children playing on the playground, that they engage in playing on the playground, that they are active with the children. They don't just encourage the children to be active, they actually should play. However, when we look at interviews with early childhood education, individuals, teachers, people who are working with training, what we find is that being on the playground actually represents a time when children are supposed to be autonomous. This is supposed to be the children's playtime. I am not supposed to interfere with this. I am supposed to facilitate them trying to improve their social skills. Can they negotiate if they both want to play in the same sandpit at the same time? I am supposed to keep them safe. Number one, I've got to keep them safe. I'm not supposed to play. I'm supposed to supervise and make sure they don't get hurt while they're on the playground, because playgrounds are dangerous, right? Many early childhood teachers often say, you know what, that's my breathing space. I get to go, okay, I don't have to organize them. I don't have, all my job is stand here and keep them safe. I get to breathe, right? This is not bash early childhood people, that's reality. If I'm in the classroom at 7:30 in the morning and I am responsible for 10 or 12, X number of children, depending which state you're in, from 7:30 until 6:00 at night, I need, right? So this is not, it's not anyone's fault. It's just the way things pan out in many childcare centers across the country. So we see lots of modeling by teachers in the classroom. They model reading, they model playing in the sandbox, inside or the water table, they model drawing, threading beads, they model sitting at the lunch table and eating healthy foods and good table manners, and then when they come out on the playground, now they don't model. Okay? Highly unlikely that you see a lot of modeling out on the playground. So the paper that really put the pieces together for me was this Diamond and Coleman. They used a technique of comparing the perception of early childhood educators with a reality that they were able to measure. And it was like this light bulb moment. I suddenly went, oh, blimey, of course, that's how I can do it. And so what they were looking at was what the teachers thought was happening during outside play. And the first point that they made was that teachers think children are highly active when they're on the playground. They are running around, they're jumping, they're crazy. Children are really active when they're on the playground. That's what the teachers think. However, when you measure what the children are doing, what we find is that they were in sedentary behavior for 46% of the time. So they were only active for 54% of the time. And the other point that they showed in this study was that they looked at interactions on the playground, who was playing with who on the playground. And what they found was that the majority of interactions were between a child and another child. There was very little playing occurring between the child and the teacher on the playground. And that was not surprising to the researchers, because when they had interviewed, what the teachers had said was, you know what, my role is keeping them safe. That's my job, keep them safe. So we don't see very much interaction between teachers and children. Again, this is in an average childcare, which is not what we are lucky enough to have on campus, because this is a whole different kettle of fish. Third piece of the pie then, this was the final piece, is the minimum health guidelines for adults. So the CDC, the Surgeon General, the Department for Health and Human Services all show guidelines for healthy behaviors in adults. Many of them also have guidelines for younger individuals as well. Adults are recommended to meet 150 minutes per week of moderate aerobic activity, or 75 minutes of vigorous aerobic activity, or some combination thereof. And so if we take the slightly less dramatic version, 150, because I'm a movement person, and vigorous activity is kind of, I've got to really be in the mood for that. But I can make myself go for a walk pretty much any day, right? So we'll look at the moderate guideline. That's 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week. Okay, that doesn't seem that bad to those of us who are committed to moving on a regular basis. But for someone who is not committed, for someone that you are trying to get engaged in physical activity, a 30 minute, I get up at 5, I make breakfast, I drag my kids out of bed, I have to force the toothbrush in their mouth, I have to drive them to school, I have to get to work, I don't have time for lunch, I have to keep working, I have to leave early to go, right? 30 minutes, that ain't happening. Well, but the really cool thing about the 30 minutes, when you look at the health guidelines, this is not fitness, right? This is not, I'm going to go run a marathon. This is purely for health. When you look at the health guidelines, that 30 minutes can be done in 3 10-minute blocks. So if I can cram in 10 minutes three times a day, now I can meet these guidelines. And at 150 minutes a week of moderate exercise, we see substantial health benefits. This is not just, I'm going to be a little bit more healthy. This is big change in health. So that's massive for not very much. If we can persuade people, it's not very much, right? You can do, it's a little itty bitty bit of moving every now and then, and it builds up over the week. So then I'm thinking, well, this is cool, right? Because at the CDC, Elaine runs the most amazing curriculum on the planet for early childhood. I mean, it's a really cool curriculum for these kids. And they get the opportunity to be outside, given the New Mexico weather, as often as possible, 3 to 4 times a day. And typically, an outside play session is around 25 minutes, a little bit more. Not very often is it shorter than that. So they're out there for a good period of time every day. And so I'm thinking, well, we have one piece of research in the literature that says if we're teaching early childhood majors how to run a motor skill program, we see increased heart rates and increased physical activity. We don't get the opportunity to teach them how to run the motor skill program because there's not room in the degree plan in New Mexico. So that's unfortunate, because that would be a way of getting them more physically active. But if I can get them more active just in playtime, maybe the adults, the students could meet healthier outcomes as well as the children. So I was trying to kind of put the whole picture together. And the problem is we really don't know very much about what the early childhood educators, what the students, what the teachers are actually doing themselves on the playground. Most of the literature looks at what are the children doing on the playground. Right? So our purpose. Right? What are they thinking? What are the students, the early childhood education majors, thinking they're doing on the playground? What are they measurably actually doing on the playground? And what impact is that having on what the children are doing on the playground? So we had parental permission to film every child while they were on the playground. And Elaine did a super job of encouraging the early childhood majors, and we had 12 of them volunteer for the study, which was really cool, because anyone who does any work with adults knows that you always get quite a big dropout rate. So I was like, oh, this is going to be great. Three of them will volunteer, and by week three, we won't have any data left. We'll be done. So it was great to start off with 12. And the first part was, okay, what is it they perceive? What do they think they're doing out there? And so Beth is a strong qualitative researcher, and so she jumped in there and did one-on-one, not group-focused type interviews, but one-on-one interviews with the students, trying to get at what they think they do on the playground. So buried in amongst a lot of questions were some that would give us a clue as to what they think they're doing out there. So we did make sure that they understood at the beginning of the interview what the recommended activity levels were. So, you know, this is what the DHHS says you should be doing. Okay, do you think you're gonna meet that when you're out on the playground? And at the same time that they were doing their interview, we took height, weight, and resting heart rate data so that we could program the monitors for individual data collection when the students were out on the playground. And we videoed the play sessions, and Dr. Culpepper had some experience with a tool and instrument called SoFit, which looks at physical activity levels in a PE environment. And there was an additional version, SoPlay, that's looking at physical activity in a free play setting. So that was really useful because rather than literally trying to sit there and code every behavior while the children were playing, we could film a little bit of the play session and code from the video. And so the filming involves scanning, panning across the playground, and he and Aaron decided that a 4-second pan gave them the best inter-rata reliability. They tried a 2-second pan, but that didn't give them very much agreement. So we used a 4-second pan left to right, and then a 4-second pan back right to left. The protocol asks you to be consistent with the coding, so on a left to right pan they coded the boys, right to left pan they coded the girls. There's also some coding on what the adults in the picture are doing at that time. And so play can give you a measure of sedentary, moderate, and vigorous activity. We actually used MVPA, where can I write? I can't write this anywhere where everybody can see it. MVPA is moderate to vigorous physical activity. That's the measure that is the most used in the literature in play and physical education. So that was the one that we went with. And so to actually monitor what the students were doing, we used anti-heart monitors, and they're really small, very light. You clip them onto some electrode pads. Unless you have some reaction to the gel on the electrode pad, you basically don't know you've got it on once it's installed. And they can pick up heart rate, physical activity count. It also records interbeat interval, but that's way over what we want to use it for. So heart rate and physical activity count is really where we're concentrating. And Elaine learned how to put those on, and because all the students last semester were female, and the GA who was helping out was male, it wasn't really appropriate. And my initial plan had been that he would put them on because he has a lot of ex-phys and physical activity background, but it just wasn't really the right thing to do. So Elaine jumped in and did the ActiHeart attachment for us before the students went out onto the playground, and then collected it when they came back and sent it back to us. And then we downloaded the data from the monitor into the software, and then we can see what's actually going on. It records 15-second epochs, so we got a lot of data within a 25-minute period. All right, so what did we find? This is so fun. So out of the interviews, so out of the 12, 10 of the students perceived that they would be engaged enough to be working at moderate level for the majority of the time they were on the playground. And we filmed them three times, each student. So either a morning or a lunchtime or an afternoon play session, depending on when we could all coordinate our timetables. And so we got three play sessions for every student. And 10 of them said that for the majority of the 25 minutes, they were going to be really active while they were out there. Is that right? Okay. So that's what we think. The SoPlay data indicated that on average, across play sessions, the children were engaged in MVPA for 46% of the time. So sedentary, low activity for 54% of the time. The range was 22 to 70. 22 is really scary. We've got some children on the playground who do diddly squish when they are on the playground. They sit in the sand. So that's a little bit concerning. On the other end of the spectrum, there were some children who were really, really engaged for 70% of the time. Well, that's pretty amazing, I think, for that age group, because they tend to work in fits and starts. You know, they've only got little itty-bitty hearts and little itty-bitty lungs. They can't run for half an hour like adults can. So that looks really good to me. Unfortunately, we don't, as far as I'm aware, we don't know right now what is how much for them. Right? Is 50% good or bad? It's certainly it's certainly typical across the published data. I've seen anything from 45% sedentary to 61% sedentary. So if our guys are sedentary for 54, we're right slap bang in the area that the literature is indicating. Is that good or bad? I don't know. There's nothing, we don't know yet how much they need in order to achieve what we want. So then we look at the actual physiological data, and here we have a bit of a disconnect. So at this point, we had to drop one student's data because it was just not clean. For some reason, we could not get the heart rate monitor to pick up clean data on this one particular student. So we were down to 11 sets of data by the time we had finished looking, doing the initial prelim on the data. And out of the 11, four of the students had an average MET that was in the moderate intensity range. So I'll go into that in a bit more detail. So a MET is a measure of intensity, work output. It is related to oxygen use while you're moving. I suspect that since we're at 4,000 feet, that this data is not quite as accurate as the software would have us believe it is, because things are a little bit different as we get up in altitude. But here is, and this is just, this is an average right now. This was our starting point. So these are their average activity levels across the three sessions that we collected on them. And when you are using METs, 3 to 6 is moderate activity. Anything over 6 is vigorous. Anything under 3 is really low activity or nothing going on, right? So you can see here that we got participant 1, participant 2, 4, and 6 all managed an average that just got into moderate. Now, the problem with averages, of course, is that they bury all the detail and the interesting stuff. But we don't have averages that are at 5.5. We have averages that are just into moderate. So we're looking at each day for each person in more detail at the moment. And off the top of my head, participant 6, for example, has one block of time that is 9 minutes long where she was in moderate or vigorous activity for the entire 9 minutes. That's like, yay! Because, yeah, A, it dragged her average up because there wasn't much going on some of the other points in time. But also, if I can do 9 minutes, I can do 10 minutes, right? So if I get 10 minutes, I'm starting to move towards meeting my own personal health goal. So that's exciting to me, because now I can go back to the students and go, look, some of you are almost there already. Just do a little bit more. Okay. So the averages right now are interesting. It'll be more interesting, I think, once we've had a closer look at every piece of time. If I can find, I'm not sure that we're going to see another big block of 9 minutes anywhere, but we've got some other blocks that look quite interesting that we're going to take a closer look at. When we download the data into the software and we look, this is the initial picture that we get. And unfortunately, I could not work out how to get this in color. So, but up on the top picture is a little squiggly line that some of you might just be able to see. That's the heart rate data. The black tall blocks on the top one are the activity, and then here is a MET calculation at the bottom. So it gives you a visual. Now I can click on a block of activity, drag across, highlight it, and I can get detailed information about what was going on in that block of time. And I don't have to pay attention to the rest of it that's there. And we can dump the data into Excel, and we get a very ugly spreadsheet because it has a data point every 15 seconds for 25 minutes for 3 days, and it's a really horrid spreadsheet. But I'm going to come back to this picture in a minute, because there's something that's quite interesting about the raw data. So what does it tell us? We're looking at humans on the playground. And what are we learning about what we do, how we behave? How can we impact that behavior? Clearly, the early childhood majors are not very good at telling how much work they're doing when they're on the playground. Okay? That's just the picture at the moment. They think they're being physically active. They believe they're being physically active at a high enough level to be healthy, and yet the physiological data clearly shows that is not the case. How can an adult be quite so off on their judgment? Part of that is maybe they're not very experienced at moving. We find that people who are not experienced tend to make poor judgments. The more moving I do, the better I am at guessing how hard I'm working. But if we go back to the raw data, then it's quite interesting if you look at the top line, the activity, that we have nothing, 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 and then we get, and this is just a minute and a half worth of data out of 25 minutes. Nothing, 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 and then I move for 30 seconds, right? Well, so possibly the perception is, well, of course I move. I don't take a chair out and sit down on the chair in the middle of the playground for 25 minutes. Of course I'm moving. However, when you look at the MET data down here, that moving didn't transfer into anything meaningful when we look at intensity and how hard you're working. So that might be part of the picture why we're getting an incorrect analysis of their behavior. Okay. If they're not being physically active, and they're not on the whole, they're not modeling physical activity to the children. And they're not modeling motor skills to the children. So I've watched them a few times, and they will play a game of chase from one end of the playground to the other end of the playground. It takes a few seconds, and that's it. Every now and then they'll climb up on the steps for the slide and they'll jump off into the sand, and that's it. Are they running around the playground with a soccer ball, playing soccer with the kids? No. Right? So there's a limited number of motor skills when they do move, and that's not happening very much. So that could be impacting why we're not seeing more physical activity by the children, because that's not what they're being shown. When they go outside, they're not getting, you should be having all the fun running around being crazy. Okay. What I believe, and this is a bit of a leap maybe, I think that it would be fair to argue that I'm taking a bit of a leap, but what I believe is that since we don't know whether 50% is enough, I don't think it's enough. If it was enough, the children would be better at their fundamental motor skills, they would be more physically active, and we would not have 4, 5, 6-year-olds who are developing obesity. So my personal belief is that that kind of around 50% activity on the playground cannot be enough. And then the question becomes, what are they doing when they go home? Right? So if I'm the parent and I'm paying for my child to go to school with people who I think know what they're doing, right? They're early childhood specialists, I think it would be reasonable to say, they're probably getting plenty of physical activity at school. They're running around all day being nuts with all their friends at school. So it's okay, if they want to come home and watch a video, I'm gonna let them put the video in and just sit down, because they kind of need to chill out, right? Except they didn't get any physical activity at school. Because when we look at typical curriculums across the whole school day, 80% of that curriculum is sedentary. On average, only 3% of a childcare day is spent in moderate to vigorous physical activity. So our 50% in our 25 minutes doesn't mean enough across the whole day. It sure as heck is not enough across the whole week, in my opinion. So we've got to do more. We've got to find a way of getting them more physically active somehow. There I'm stumped. I've been working on this for a very long time. And getting them active when I'm on the playground is easy. They are super duper active when I am out there, because I'm a nutcase when I'm on the playground. But when I leave, they're not active anymore. And I've been trying to impact the teachers for a long time, and it's been very difficult. So this is another attempt. We're taking a slightly different tack this time. All right, so what are we up to now? Because we're not finished yet, we don't think. We want to have another go. What happens if we educate the early childhood majors? So Elaine noticed when she was putting the heart rate monitors on that she felt the students acted differently when they went on the playground. That she saw several times that when they had the monitor, when they knew they were being monitored, she felt they were more active than they were when they went out there normally. And she mentioned that to us. We're like, oh, okay. And so Beth decided, all right, then I'm gonna add another interview, kind of mid data collection, and ask them what they felt about having the heart rate monitor and whether they felt that it changed how they behaved. So, you just collected that data last week, right? So last week we got interview number two. Next week I'm meeting with, we now have 8 of the 11 back at the CDC this semester. So I'm gonna meet with those 8 and I'm going to do some strategies with them. So I'll talk to them about why it's important the children are moving, but I'm also gonna talk to them about their opportunity to help themselves be more healthy. And I'll give them some ideas of things they could be doing that wouldn't be too taxing. You know, it's not like you have to sit down and plan PE. It's, you've got a great playground, you can do this. And we'll go out and collect the video and analyze code with the SOPI and collect some more ActiHeart data. I'm also thinking there's a phone app, Azumio, that you can track your heart rate. You put your finger on the camera and it gives you your heart rate at that moment in time. So if they act differently when the heart rate monitors are on, maybe if they can track, because they can't see what their heart rate is from the monitor. It's not like a heart rate watch. So I'm wondering if I give them the app and they can check their own heart rate while they're out on the playground, whether that would encourage them to pick it up a little bit more while they're out there. And then Beth's a glutton for punishment. She's gonna go back and interview them again at the end. And any of you that have done qualitative information and studies know that that is a heap of data analysis. And so go back at the end and ask them if they think they changed anything. And then we can take that and compare it to what they actually did and see whether they really did change anything. So, fingers crossed. I don't know, we'll see. So, that's what I hope, that's what I believe, that's what I think. And we can help the kids. I think we can create physical activity habits in the children that will carry them through school and hopefully into life after school. I think we can help the early childhood students learn to be more physically active. And if they learn to be more physically active, maybe they'll be the set of teachers that take that out onto the playground to the children. We'll see. I don't know. Thank you very much.
Longitudinal studies, like on your SOPLAY videos from the very beginning of this project to the end, you know, in late April or May.
And I've thought about that as well, is even, so look at what's happening with the children, Some of these girls hopefully will be back in the fall, but I wondered whether I could maybe encourage them to monitor their physical activity across the summer, because that's part of the problem. I can get them active for a few weeks on the playground, but if they don't keep it up, they're not going to transfer it when they become teachers, when they go out into the workplace. So I've got some ideas for trying to get to track them further down the line. Right now I don't know how many of them, you know, where they are in their study and how long they're going to be around for, so I've got to find that out this semester.
You mentioned that perhaps the altitude might be influencing your data, and I was just curious if you know if anybody's looked at those fundamental movements and if those translate, if anybody's looked across altitude gradients to see if people who grow up in different areas end up with, you know, if they don't do much at higher elevations.
I have never seen a study looking at that. That would be interesting, because if it's more difficult, maybe we don't do as much of it.
Or they just habituate from the two.
Yeah. I have not seen any studies looking at the development of fundamental motor skills at altitude. No.
It'd be good in New Mexico because we have all these different elevations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Pricey, but good idea. Yes.
Okay, Sarah, do you consider yourself a PE teacher?
Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking maybe that's why you're so active on the playground. The children run after you.
No, I'm just crazy. I'm not a trained PE teacher. My background is motor development, so I didn't do teacher ed information. But I used to coach full time before I moved away from coaching. So I've always taught little children, because in gymnastics we start on really too young. So I've always worked with preschool since I was a teenager. I love working with preschool people rather than adults. I find adults very frustrating. I try to teach adult fitness classes. I can't be going there. It is too hard to motivate adults. It is so easy to motivate little people. So I copped out.
But you're trying to get the early childhood candidate mm-hmm. to be a model on the playground.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen some of these candidates
mm-hmm.
over the 15 years I've been a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just thinking, isn't it getting a bit late to get physical in your 20s? I just don't know if that's going
to happen. That is part of the problem, is if they don't have a background of being physically active and now you're asking them to suddenly become physically active, it is a challenge. We haven't, when I was at Auburn, it was one of the goals of the motor skill intervention was not just to work with the children, but to get the teachers in. We were in a very low income childcare center there, and we were just trying to get the teachers to do anything, because they were big ladies, and anything. 5 years. I tried for 5 years, and we got nowhere. Every time we walked away, they stopped moving, and they sat back down in the shade. And it's hard. It is. It's very difficult, and you know, I don't see it getting any easier if we don't put PE and recess right in the schools. And just a quick shout out, we shouldn't have got rid of the last ditch effort to get the students busy in college. Just saying. That was a bad plan.
There's a question there, include track back these students. Childhood. So basically, you trace back each individual student to know how active they were if they were younger, because then you might affect the average that they're getting, compared that average to be school and they have background, and then you have lower end. So how does that really translate to the future?
Yeah, that would be interesting. No, I like that
idea. I think that would be, a reference.
Well, and it would, when you look at the couple of girls who were quite a bit more active compared to the rest of the group, what's their background compared to?
Right, and also take all their physical references, try to give one how much they're active. That's back to your theory, right? How much are they active based on how heavy or moving of the BMI, all those things.
Yeah.
That's also where we have those results because of the sample. So basically, a deeper understanding about, the characteristics of your sample, which is very small.
Yeah.
Therefore, better understand, the better you're able to extrapolate.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, you have another difficulty because their perception of their current activity is not good, which suggests their perception of their activity when they were young is probably not the
You've got
ill-posed problems there.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
But no, yeah.
That's going to give you a sense.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had a question. You talked about the importance of adults, being good model for the children. So it's good for the adult and for the child.
Yeah.
Isn't it enough if you have very active children, they cannot be role models for themselves? If you have very good active kids.
Jump in here if I'm wrong. My understanding is that at this age, they don't use their peers as a role model. It's as they get older, they start to use their peer group as role models. When they're 3, 4, 5, the adult is the role model.
I would say the referencing to the adult is certainly a high priority for children at that age. Certainly we've seen in some of our 5 and 6 year olds who haven't gone off to kindergarten who maybe had a delayed entry, sometimes their peer interaction is a lot stronger at that point because they're starting to shift developmentally into that phase of being more centered on their peers. But still, I think what we have noticed just in general is when adults aren't doing something, the children don't feel the emphasis on it unless they find some internal motivation to move forward in maybe a play of pretend or something that would allow them to. So, it's probably variable based on the child and based on the relationship they've built between the adult and the children.
I saw that you have athletes sometimes on the playground.
Yes.
Almost every day.
Yeah, they're because a lot of the athletes are in HPE, and so they do. It's interesting. When I was in Auburn, I ran the class that I do here for early childhood students, and you would take them to the playground, and they were really great at engaging the children and chatting, and they were horrible at getting moving, And then now here I have the PE students who can't wait to get the balls and throw and run around, but can I get them down here to actually talk to the kids? And so it's a different challenge, but yeah, that does help.
Yeah.
Out here, the children they've got an unbelievable lab school environment. They've got well-educated teachers. They've got tons of toys to play with. They've got a massive playground. Their playground is bigger than most childcare centers. It's huge. I was kind of hoping that we would find that our kids were more active than the average representation in the literature because they've got all these advantages, and yet we didn't get that. So that's interesting to me because there was a little sneaky voice going, oh, they're going to be up at like 60-65%. Not most of them.
Did you do any kind of a gender breakdown among students and the children?
We didn't have any amongst the students. Last semester we only had female early childhood majors. We do have a little bit of data splitting boys and girls. The boys were about 51% in moderate to vigorous physical activity. The girls were a bit lower, so the average was 46. Mm-hmm. The boys were more active. And that's typical. By about the age of 4, we start to see boys being more active than girls, and that just gets bigger and bigger and bigger as we get older. The girls never come back. So from 4 onwards, the girls choose to be more sedentary.
Do you think that might be connected at all to role modeling in society in general?
Yeah, or there's nowhere near the amount of encouragement to young girls to be physically active that there is to the boys. And it's better now than it's ever been.
Yes.
It's improving, but it's still not enough. I mean, the last Olympics, we saw beach volleyball all the time. I'm sure that's probably because the male producer liked the bikinis, but it gave the girls a lot of role modeling, so that's okay. I'll go with the bikinis.
Yeah.
Seems good to me. Beach volleyball! Yeah.
I was curious, sorry if you covered this. But,
oh, that's okay.
But in the survey, did you learn what the potential role modeling they got at home was, and if that was different from what one might expect?
I defer to Beth on that one, because
I didn't ask about that. So.
No, but that ties in a bit.
Yeah, it was
this
with
idea.
Of finding out what kind of thing. Yeah, and I could go back and ask that as well, because that's not going to change really from the beginning to the end. So that's something that we could look at.
I'm going to, excuse me, right here we can continue the discussion outside. I want people to eat the food.